Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here at Central Baptist Church, CBC. Seems I have taken a little bit of ribbing from my mistake last week. I couldn't remember where I was at. So thank you all for showing up today. Beautiful spring day. Almost should be doing church outside so we can enjoy it. But our announcements. Today, baby shower for Samantha Robertson right after church. Oh, no, excuse me, it's at 2 p.m. I should read the announcements myself. But I always forget the most important thing about the announcements is to read the announcements. So we'll let you guys read them. But there is a new ladies' Bible study starting Thursday, April 18th. Our potluck is coming on Sunday, the 21st. The Hope for Journey Conference on April 26th and 27th. There is a deacon meeting this Thursday, the 18th, at 6:30. As far as I can see, I kind of touched base on all of them. If there's any others, quick announcements. Okay. Thank you for that. We'll open in a word of God's Word. We're going to be in Psalms 124. A song of ascents of David. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when people rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us up alive. When their anger was kindled against us, then the flood waters would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us. Then over us would have gone the raging waters. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snares of the fowler. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who has made heaven and earth. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, if it had not been for you who was on our side, Lord, you are on our side when we face temptations. You are on our side, Lord, when we face troubles. You are on our side, Lord, when we face doubts. Lord, we just thank you that we can remember that if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, what we would be facing now if we didn't know who you were. Lord, help us to remember that your help is our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. In Christ Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Mark. Let's stand and sing together for a thousand times.
Just the
God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Leviticus chapter 17. Verse 1 to 11. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to Aaron and his sons and to all the people of Israel, and say to them, this is the thing that the Lord has commanded. If any of the house of Israel kills an ox or a lamb or a goat in the camp, or kills it outside the camp, does not bring it to the entrance of the tent of meeting to offer it as a gift to the Lord in front of the tabernacle of the Lord, blood guilt shall be imputed to that man. He has shed blood, and that man shall be cut off from among his people. This is to the end that the people of Israel may bring their sacrifices, that they sacrifice in the open field. They may bring them to the Lord, to the priest at the entrance of the tent of meeting, and sacrifice them as sacrifices of peace offerings to the Lord. And the priest shall throw the blood on the altar of the Lord at the entrance of the tent of meeting, and burn the fat for a pleasing aroma to the Lord. So they shall no more sacrifice their sacrifices to goat demons, after whom they whore. This shall be a statute forever for them throughout their generations. And you shall say to them, any one of the house of Israel or of the strangers who sojourn among them, who offers a burnt offering or sacrifice, does not bring it to the entrance of the tent of meeting to offer it to the Lord, that man shall be cut off from his people. If any one of the house of Israel or the strangers who sojourn among them eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by the life." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather here this morning, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the blood of the one who stood in our place. Lord, you are the potter, we are the clay. We gather here as clay needing molding, Lord, needing to be changed, needing to think about things in light of who you are and what you've said. And Lord, I thank you that you have not left us hanging, that we just don't have to wander aimlessly in this world. We have the Word of God and the Spirit of God that has taken up residence in those of us who have by faith have trusted Christ. And so we stand on that alone, and on that authority, we stand here before you as vessels needing to be molded, to be shaped. Lord, many of us, myself included, have come after long, hard weeks. Things have not been easy. There's been no giggling going on, Lord. It's been tough. And we come here as a hospital, as it were, Lord, needing to be built up, needing to be brought back into an understanding, a clear understanding of the faith, to worship together, to sing back to you that which we believe about you, Lord, as from your word. So we do that as a family, and that's a special thing. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity we have to be together today. I pray that the word of God would increase in our hearts and grow fruit in our lives. I thank you for the shed work of Jesus Christ, the blood, Lord, that was spilled for us, Lord, to make atonement for our souls. Lord, I thank you for that. And it's with that commonality that we come together and say thank you. Would you be pleased to our time here in Christ's name? Amen.
Continue to sing together. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as we
death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should
be seated.
Morning. Yeah. So this is a one-off. Anybody know what a one-off is? Nobody knows what. I'm a kind of a one-off kind of guy. Matt knows what a one-off is. We've been doing something. We've been teaching along the scriptures, and now we're going to take a break. I.e., Deemer's gone this week, and so you get the one-off guy. And we're going to pick back up, I think, in the book of Genesis. But I was thinking this morning, someone made a comment in Sunday school that you don't act like you're nervous. Well, that's just quite the opposite. I don't know how many of you have ever had the privilege of standing before people and proclaiming the Word of God. It's not always easy. So if you think there's a calm, cool, collected guy standing before you right now, then don't fool yourself. When you first start out preaching, you want to nail it, and you always call, or now I guess you text your buddies, and you say, hey, pray for me, I'm preaching, you know? And you say, you know, oh yeah, we'll pray for you. But really what I mean by that is that I hope I don't do anything stupid. I mean, it's not really that I want to handle the Word of God accurately, it's just I don't want to look like a fool. Well, it's too late for that. I do that on my own pretty good. But really what I want us to do is I want us to understand the text. That's at 45, I'm more there than I am worried about looking stupid. So, a quote that I heard once, the Christian life from one angle is the long journey of letting our natural assumption about who God is over many decades fall away, being slowly replaced with God's own insistence on who he is. This is hard work. I'm going to say that again because I needed to hear it twice and you might too. The Christian life from one angle is the long journey of letting our natural assumption about who God is over many decades fall away, being slowly replaced with God's own insistence on who he is. This is hard work. That is the Christian life, isn't it? We have assumptions, and are assumptions based on reality, or are they based on some sort of monster that we've created or that culture has taught us? We're going to dive into a little passage here in the book of Hebrews this morning, Hebrews chapter 4, and I titled our sermon, Jesus is More Better, and I'm not dumb enough that I know that's not good English, but I'm also smart enough to know if I say it that way, you might remember it. So let's do that. We want to go back and understand the reality of the people of this letter and who was written to and its significance for us today. The writer of Hebrews, we don't know who that is, was writing to an audience who were being tempted to fall back into a different system. Christ had come, his work had been accomplished, and these people were being tempted to go back to what you might call an Old Testament ritual, to the old way of doing things that predates Christ's work. They lacked confidence in the sufficiency of the gospel, and consequently their Lord. They were in danger of going back to Judaism. These are the people this letter is written to. And I think there's ample evidence this is applicable to us today. They were looking back to the old forms and ceremonies, patterns. They were hung up in temple worship. They had gone beyond Judaism receiving Jesus, but they were tempted to hang on to that habit. It was hard for them to make a clean break. They wanted to mix the new with the old. Maybe that's where we find ourselves in some level. We want to have our cake and eat it too. Anybody else guilty of that? I want to have what I used to do
and I want to embrace Jesus. I want to do it all. And in missiology, they call that syncretism. They've taken the old system with the new system, they blended them together, and you're most happy in that place, and you're really not. The book of Hebrews was written to give floundering believers, it was written to them to give them hope, to hang on to the better covenant that is Jesus. Don't go back to those old patterns. Must now live out exclusively their new relationship with Christ. Jesus is saying, this book is saying, Hebrews is saying that Jesus is more better than anything else. Well, what is he more better than? Angels? Moses? The law? Any Old Testament person, institution, ritual, or sacrifice? He is better than anyone and everything else. He's more better. He is telling the people, listen, guys, we've got the answer. I know it's hard. I know you don't really understand why things are the way they are, but we have Christ. He's better than anything you've been able to grasp thus far. And hang on to that. He's the one that atoned for our sins. That's the tone of Hebrews. That's the backstory that we need to understand. And so I believe that the Spirit of God is using the incidents of our lives, maybe even just this week, I know for me he did, to show that Jesus is all the more better. All the more better than anything else that we could ever put our hope, faith, trust in is Christ. So this epistle contrast reigns. In literary terms, it's called a foil. They're contrasting things constantly in this book. Give you a little more backstory. Everything is presented as better, a better hope testament, a better promise, a better sacrifice, a better substance, a better country, a better resurrection, a better everything. Jesus Christ is presented as the supreme best. Why is it good news to find out that Jesus is our high priest? Well, let's stand and read the word. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then, with confidence, draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let's pray. Father, again, we're here. We gather under the Word of God with the Spirit of God, and we ask that you illuminate the truth to our hearts today. Pray for distraction that would be mindful to take hold of those things and deal with them later, but to now focus in on what you would have us hear in this passage in Hebrews about our high priest, about the Lord Jesus and his work. Be gracious to us, we ask, Lord. We're not deserving, and you know that. But that's the tone or the definition of grace, Lord, that you would be gracious to us to open our eyes, that Jesus would be seen as more supreme because we were here and heard the word of God this morning. For your glory and our good, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Christ is called the high priest. So what was a high priest? We must understand what a high priest does, even if we're going to understand that Jesus is our high priest. I taught Awana for a lot of years. And I love pictures, and I taught Native Americans as well, and pictures are important. So you're going to see a few pictures this morning, and it'll even maybe help some of these little guys stay engaged too. We must understand that Jesus is our high priest. John Piper said, God designed Israel's history so that when Jesus came, he would make sense in light of that history. There's no way you'll be able to understand the book of Hebrews and God's message to us today if you don't understand the Old Testament system and how Israelites properly related to God. If you don't get the fact that there's sin in the world, and God used priests to sacrifice animals, and through the blood, man was made right with God, that mankind is connecting with God through a sacrifice, you absolutely have to understand it. It's always been this way since the fall. Sacrifice is the means to which God has related, which man has related to God properly. Hence our passage earlier, Leviticus 17:11. And this is true today, just as true, only that we connect to God through Jesus in his sacrifice on the cross, through his completed work. The New Testament, specifically the book of Hebrews, makes mention many times of this lingos, what Jesus did for believers. Some of the roles, as you think about those pictures there, are the high priest. The chief function of the high priest was the superintendence of the temple, tabernacle worship. The high priest was the head of the Jewish state. He was the head, guru, the head religious person. He was to offer sacrifices for the sins of the people. He would go into the Holy of Holies one time a year on the Day of Atonement. And he would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat, which was lid of the Ark of the Covenant, thus making atonement for the sins of the people. What was in there? Do you guys remember? It's kind of rhetorical. But the point being is there was three elements in there I think it's really important to understand, because the symbolism that's here is important for us to grasp. Aaron's rod that budded, a symbol of the rejection of the people's, a symbol of the rejection of God's leadership for the people. The two tablets, a rejection of God's law. And a pot of manna, a rejection of God's provision. As no other human instrument could, he represented God before the people and the people before God. That was the role of a high priest. This is reality. This is what happened for a while on planet Earth where we live here. Does that make sense? I think there's an element, I just want to park on my little hobby horse, there's an element to think, well, this was like somewhere else. Well, yeah, it may have been geographically somewhere else, but this thing really happened. What happened here in these pictures, these are real things that happened. And this is how we related to God until Jesus came. Leviticus 16 tells us that before the high priest could enter the Holy of Holies, he had to much less offer a sacrifice for himself. Why? Because he himself is a sinner. Not only that, but his time in the Holy of Holies was very limited. He was only allowed to stay in the presence of the Shekinah glory of God only while making the sacrifice. Every year, year after year after year, this Yom Kippur, this was necessary. Between these yearly sacrifices, every day, day after day, thousands of other sacrifices were made. Meat, produce. The process never ended. On and on and on it went. Never completed, because the priesthood was not perfect. The sacrifices were not perfect. These were mere men. So this was as common as anything for a Jew to understand the role of a high priest, much as you would understand what an electrician does or an accountant or something like that. It would be a normal job. So if you're a Jew in this time and understanding, you understand this role. I don't have time to go into the depths of the role of the high priest. So now we're brought to our passage. Let's look to Hebrews chapter 4. These priests were normal people of the tribe of Levi in the day, but they had no mystical power to be able to bring someone to God. Verse 14. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. Verse 14 says that Jesus is the high priest and he passed through the heavens. He left earth, Acts chapter 1, verse 9, that is the atmosphere, and went through what the scripture refers to as the second heaven into the third heaven, and this is where God dwells today, the Holy of Holies. What is being said here is that Jesus is the one who has made that role of a high priest now. He is the one making intercession before the Father on our behalf. And he's saying, this is as good as it gets. You've got God's Son as the one who is now making intercession for you, for me. How much better does it get? The old priest would have had to offer a sacrifice for himself, as well as for the people, because he was a sinner. But we have the spotless Lamb that stood in our place to become sin for us. There's a completeness connotation here. God gave the people classification. Turn to Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 to 4. I think it's important to illustrate Scripture with Scripture, and there's a time and a place for a story. I have one, but I think here is, we understand Christ's sacrifice for all. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 to 4. For since the law was but a shadow of the good things to come, instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, Would they have not ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. When Satan lies to us, which he does, and we go to God, we can go to God with confidence, knowing that the Son of God has atoned for our sins. The Christian life is so simple and yet so hard. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing is the work of Christ. I found myself time and time again this week going back to the simple fact is that I'm a horrible, wretched sinner. God loves me and has provided for me a way in Christ. Just a simple fact. Think about it. When God sees the blood, when he looked down on the sins of the people, what did he see? What did he see on the mercy seat? That was the priest's blood. It was the blood. When God looked at it, he didn't see the sin, he saw the blood. We are now justified by faith because of Jesus. Turn to Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. 9 years ago, this coming fall, I was helping a friend preg check his cows in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains in Alberta. And thought I could get through this story. Anyways, helping a friend preg check his cows, and I was bringing cows up to the chute, and the vet was there, and my friend Harley and his wife Sarah were there. And they were arming the cows and checking to see if they were bred, for those who don't know what that means. I started to feel a burning in my back. I'm like, what is going on? This isn't right. So as I started to hurt more, started doing this a little bit, we finished up, went inside, had a cup of coffee and some roast, and felt better. The wind picked up, and he said, hey, I got like four pairs I couldn't find yesterday. We should probably go find them. You want to go with me? And I said, yeah, I'll go with you. So we went out, I got my horse, and we went and rode about 2 miles, and we found these four pairs kind of nestled in some trees, and we brought them to the corrals, weaned the calves, and now my back is really starting to hurt, like really bad. He's like, well, I got some fencing to do. Ranchers are great at getting free labor out of people. They're just really good at, hey, you're here, you know. I said, well, I better go home. I'm not feeling so good. So I said, okay. Or he said, okay. So I loaded my horses in the trailer and drove about 20, 30 minutes home. And unsaddled the horses, put the horses away. Came into the house, and Amanda was on the phone, and I said, you need to get off the phone. We need to talk. She's like, well, I'll be a second. I said, no, you need to get off the phone now. And she got off the phone, wasn't feeling well. And so I sat there and tried to figure it out. So then ended up going to the emergency room in a town called Black Diamond. Walked in, and I got cow manure all over me. And smelled bad, and you know, that kind of thing. And told the lady at the counter, I said, I don't feel really good. Got a burning in my back. And she said, okay. So they rushed me into the emergency room, and they whipped my shirt off and snap buttons and put all these things all over my chest. And was there for a little bit, and the doctor came walking by and said to the nurse, he said, well, he's having one. And I looked at the nurse, and I was like, what does one mean? And she just went, so what do you do? The man that comes in with Anna in her stomach at that time, very, very pregnant with number 5, and I'm going, whoa, this is the real deal. Turns out they gave me some clot buster that kind of cleared all that up, and they said, you need to go to Calgary. So I got in the ambulance. Now I'm really scared, and laying there in the back of an ambulance with my, you know, pregnant wife, probably in a vehicle behind me at some level, and Romans 5:1 comes to my mind. Don't tell me that the Spirit of God doesn't use the Word of God. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know what? In that moment and right now, God was okay with me because of Jesus. I meet a lot of people in my life who tell me that, Oh, I'm good with God. I'm good. God and I are good. Says you. What does God have to say about that? He's made it clear right here about how he feels. My justification, my rightness with God is based on somebody else. It's on faith in the Lord Jesus. Romans 5:1 says it. And so as I'm laying there in this ambulance on my way to Calgary, my very pregnant wife following me and wondering what's going on, the Spirit of God uses this. You know what I did? It's going to be all right. God's okay with me. God is okay with me. How can I not be at peace? He's at peace with my life because of Christ. The rest of the story, years later, I had a heart, cardiac MRI. There's no damage done to my heart. It was a minor heart attack. But nevertheless, wouldn't trade it for the world from what I learned from that. So the high priest stood before and stands before us today as the one who will hold fast our confession, our true profession of faith. And I know in that moment right there, God's good with me, I can be at peace. He holds fast. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 4. It'd be really handy if I would have marked this. You stand up in front of people, you're like, well, where's Hebrews again? It's in the New Testament. Thank you. Literally, hold fast means to take possession, to be strong. It has perseverance connotation. Hold fast. So in the moment, when you feel like life's falling apart and you're laying in the ambulance on the way to Calgary or whatever it is, keep on keeping on. It's like, Joel, I'm okay with you right now. Relax. That's what he's telling us. One of the greatest gifts God's given us is each other. As we walk through life, we sojourn together. There's this archetype in Scripture of a sojourner. We're just like, this isn't our home, but this is where we're at kind of connotation. And I feel like sometimes people think we're like spiritual. They feel like they can be like a spiritual Rambo, just kind of walking through life, just me and God. We're just going to do this thing. That's not the fact. That's not the Christian life. The Christian life is walking together with one another. God hasn't asked us to be doing this on our own. He's given us the truth. He's given us the Spirit of God. He's given us each other. A couple weeks ago, it was last week, Deemer preached on John 17. The whole idea of unity stuck out to me. That they may be one as the Father, as you and I are one, that is the Father in Christ. That we would walk in unity in this confession that we have of Christ and his finished work. Let's go to verse 15. Let's talk more about this high priest. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us in our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. The term in verse 15, weakness, has a feebleness connotation toward it. This is the... excuse me. I didn't have a fancy water bottle. I just got my old coffee cup. The category we have is high priest, set forth long ago here, is for Jesus to understand is that Jesus is our high priest and he continues to be. At the cross, when Christ gave up his life, what was he doing? Turn to Matthew chapter 27, verse 45. We're going to go back and see what the work of Christ, what's the big deal? What's the big deal with what Jesus did? And I realize there may be some here who don't know all this story. And if you want to know more of the story, come find me later. But I want to stick here with this because this is a game changer in our lives as Christians, what I'm about to read. 27:45 Matthew. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. And one of them once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice, and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks split. So the curtain that separated man from God was now torn in half. It's a metaphor, and it's exactly what happened. Metaphorically, now we have access to God because of what just happened. The most holy place is where the priests would go. We have access to God now because of the work of Christ. John 19:30. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What's finished? What's done? What need not happen anymore? That there, the work of Christ, is done. No more sacrifices. No more Yom Kippur. No more going in and doing the same thing over and over. The perfect sacrifice came, and he did his job. The work of redemption that the Father had given him was accomplished. Sin was atoned for, and Satan was defeated and rendered powerless. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 9 now. Verse 12. Well, yeah, let's go verse, let's go, yeah, 11 to 14. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls and goats, goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Turn over a column or two to chapter 10, verses 11 and 12. In every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. He sat down. What does that mean? It means that he's done. He's talked about our high priest. The work is finished. It's all done. It's accomplished. And he is able to sympathize with us in our weakness. He's able to understand why we don't serve like this rock that we just sit here and worship. We serve God. Jesus Christ, the one who came and lived a life and understands. He's able to sympathize with us in our weakness because he himself was tempted just as we were. A scoffer told C.S. Lewis once that if Jesus never sinned, how could he know what real temptation even is? He can't sympathize with me because he never went through it. You need to be careful what you tell C.S. Lewis. He said, a silly idea is current that good people do not know the temptation, what temptation means. This is an obvious lie. Only those who try to resist temptation know how strong it is. A man who gives in to temptation after 5 minutes simply does not know what it would have been like an hour later. That is why bad people, in one sense, know very little about badness. They have lived a sheltered life by always giving in. Christ, because he was the only man who never yielded to temptation, is also the only man who knows to the full what temptation means. The only complete realist. Jesus can sympathize with us in our pain and our dying because he experienced that pain, the excruciating pain, and he carried it all the way to his death. He sympathizes with us in our temptations to sin because he was tempted. We have a high priest who understands. Look at the last part of verse 15. Yet without sin. I can't even make it through the morning coffee without sinning. It's that quick. It's that bad. Allowing my mind to go, well, why does that guy drive a new truck and I don't? God doesn't love me like he loves him. Why does that guy have a big house and I am in this house? Why? Competition all the time. And I'm like, oh, well, I should read my Bible. It's like the mind. I go to bed tired at the end of the day because I'm fighting my brain. Constantly pouring the truth over these lies. Was Jesus tempted to lie? He understands and gets what I'm going through even before I've had my first sip of coffee. Was he tempted? Yeah. How was he tempted? To lie to save his life, maybe? Are you the Christ, the Son of the living God? To steal, to help his mother and father, to covet the nice things that Zacchaeus owned? Was he tempted to dishonor his parents when they were maybe more strict than others? To take revenge when he was wrongly accused? To lust when Mary wiped his feet with her hair? To pout with self-pity when his disciples fell asleep in the last hour of trial? To murmur at God when John the Baptist died at the whim of a dancing girl? And to gloat over his accusers when they couldn't answer his questions? Can you do that? See him? See you? Are you able to withstand temptation? Christ did. Jesus knows the battle. He fought it all the way to the end, and he defeated the monster of sin every single time. And that's our high priest, who can understand. He's more better than anything else that we could ever imagine. And we as Christians can be confronted with the truth that Lord is not he's not foreign to our experience. He felt the tug of sin, and he never succumbed to it. There's little quotes you read in life, and they really just stick. This one's one of those for me. Pastor John MacArthur said, "When people ask me about what appeals to me about heaven, it isn't the streets of transparent gold or the gates made of pearls. It's the absence of sin. I'm tired of sin, mostly my own." God isn't pacing the halls of heaven frustrated with us today because of our sin. Nope, he very much gets us. He very much understands. And he understands us well. Actually, he understands us so well because he's the one that created us. He was tempted like we are, and he never gave in. I have never once in my life looked back and regretted obedience to what God has told me to do in his word. Never once looked back and said, "Boy, God said that. I wish I would have done something else." Never once. Let's pick up verse 16, chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. "Let us now then draw in with confidence. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." The one who stands before us, Jesus, the one who is the way to draw near to God so perfectly, has provided. So what's the so what? We are now able to draw near to God in our daily lives because of the reality of Jesus Christ as our high priest. I wish we could see how big of a deal it is. I don't think we can grasp the depths of that. But I do believe part of grasping the depths of that is in the moment by moment walking with the Lord. The dailiness, the minuteness of it all. The verb draw near is the idea of visit, to move forward, to approach. It is like a dog sinking his teeth into something. That's who I am. And I'm going to put my faith in what's being said right there. We need to accept this help of mercy and grace as we draw near to him. We have the privilege to draw near to him. Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Jesus gets it. We can draw near to him right now and find mercy. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it." What other system offers that? Only the more better way of Christ offers that. In ancient days, if you think about the story of Queen Esther, I'm sure you probably know that story a little bit. She had this desire to go meet with her husband. Without permission, she could have lost her life, right? There was no confidence, but the passage tells us that she went. All the more so, the God who made us, who created us, we can go boldly before him with confidence, knowing that he understands us, that he gets us, without fear of shame or punishment. Our Savior is the friend of sinners. He came for the lowly, not for the ones who think they have it all together. The tax collectors, the sinners, the sinful woman, the lost, Zacchaeus. Contrition. Contrition is the key to coming to the Lord. No matter how sinful or undeserving someone may approach God at any time, so they will find mercy and help in God. So that can sound rather ambiguous or foreign to some people. What does that mean? I think it's in the moment by moment, as I just said, resting on the truth claims of God and who He says He is. If that's confusing to you, if that doesn't make sense, maybe heaven's not your home. Maybe you're not God's child. If there's a little bit of frustration and you don't understand what's being said, I'd love to talk to you. But the point of the matter is, for those of us who have trusted Christ and His finished work, we can rest in the fact. We can do that. Romans 5:1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is rescuing dead people. He's bringing life into them through the gospel. I'm trying to remember who said this quote, but it was years ago I heard it. As we go to Him, who's that guy that went to China? It's a Chinese guy. Anyways, it's fine. He said this. It doesn't matter who said it. It's right. When you think, as we go to Him, what looms greater in your thinking? Your sin or the blood that covers your sin? What stands preeminent in our thinking in that moment? Your sin or the blood that covers your sin as I go to the Lord in the dailiness of walking with Him? Turn with me, if you would, Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to close here in a second. 10, 19 to 23. I'm going to try and stop thinking of that Chinese guy right now. I believe it's at this level, the confidence that we can have, the full assurance of knowing who God is and what He's done, that He's more better than anything else that's being offered to us today. And as we think about this passage, I want you to think about, what is that thing? What's that thing that in your mind might be, in some terms, could be called, it was Watchman Nee. Watchman Nee said that thing earlier, sorry. It drives me nuts. Just came to me. What is that thing in your life? What is that thing that you're holding fast saying, this is what I really want? Is Jesus your most precious goal? Is He your most precious possession? Could it be a plethora of things. We're not simple-minded people, but I want you just to be thinking about that one thing as we can go to with full assurance for God and who He is and the truth claim of Him being our high priest. Hebrews 10:19. Therefore, brother, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that He opened for us through the curtain, that is through His flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for He who promised is faithful. By Christ's sacrifice of Himself, God's throne of judgment is turned into a throne of grace for those of us who will trust Him. As a Jewish priest, once a year for centuries, sprinkled blood on the mercy seat for the sins of the people, Jesus shed His blood once and for all, for all time, for the sins of everyone who would believe on Him. That is His perfected provision for us. What holds us back? What keeps us from trusting Him now? You're not trapped. Say no to the lie. If you haven't come to Christ, if you don't know what it means to have faith in Christ, what does that mean? It's a little ambiguous or unclear what I mean by that. I would love to talk to you about that. But the fact of the matter is, in what He did, His death, burial, and resurrection as our high priest, as one who stands before God making intercession for us, we can have full assurance that there's a God who just not will only pay for our sin, but He understands. Excuse me. He understands. He gets it. Do we deserve it? Of course not. You can right now and forever, if you will trust in Him as your high priest, Jesus, the Son of God, draw near to Him. Turn with me as we close, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. somebody said, I think it was Deemer a couple weeks ago, or maybe somebody up here was talking about the rear view of life. You're starting at 45, you're starting to maybe kind of see that there's a rear view mirror going on. We don't know. I mean, at 38, I had a heart attack, a minor one, but yet a heart attack. So we don't know, but the temporalness of what's going on here in this earth, it's going to be gone in a flash. For this light and momentary affliction, I'm sorry, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17 and 18. This light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you as we come before you this morning based on the work of Christ. None of us stands here on our own good merit, on our own good guy-ness, our own works. Lord, there's not one of us who's doing that well. Not good enough to even stand before you. Lord, I thank you that when you look down on us, as you did the Israelites in those days, you didn't see the sin, you see the blood. You see the high priest who stood in our place, who became sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God, that we might stand before you in a right way. We thank you for the more better sacrifice that exists in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. It's more better than anything else we could ever imagine. More better than us trying to spend our days working hard to gain your approval, which would never happen. More better than us trying to make our own sacrifices of blood to make things right with you, which would never happen. We have the one, we have the information, we have the news of the good news of the Lord Jesus. And so with that, Lord, we stand in full confidence as he's the one that gets us. He understands. He knows. And Lord, we stand with that confidence now before you, and we're in a right relationship because of that, Lord. I thank you for that. The faith in Christ alone is what makes us right, and we can trust you, Lord. I thank you for the good news of the gospel today. And I thank you that you didn't leave us hanging from the very beginning of time. Thank you for these people and our time here together. In Christ's name, amen.
Let's stand together and sing one more time.
When I fear, my faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold.
Don't get used to me, because I always finish 10 minutes earlier than Deemer does. He does a better job. But nevertheless, we got more time to visit. And I think there's no other time, than at least for me, that I'm more with like-minded people than I am for these hours in Sunday morning. Let me leave you with your benediction. It comes from Romans chapter 11, verse 33. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been his counselor? Who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, his good, pleasing, and acceptable will. God bless you.